the people with the back.
This isn't the story I wanted to tell. I wanted to tell the story of Steve McCurry, the photographer who took this photo. I wanted to talk about how this photo inspired millions of people to understand the plight of refugees, how the lighting and the color and the composition came together to make an award-winning photo that inspired me personally when it arrived on my doorstep when I was 11 years old in 1985. I can't tell you that story, though. I have to tell you a different story, and one that hasn't really been told in one piece. First, I need to take a second and thank our sponsor, Squarespace. This feels a little weird because this is a very serious topic, and I want to make sure that we do not personally profit from this in any way. So we're going to take all the money that Squarespace would pay us for the sponsorship, all the money we would make from the monetization, plus a whole bunch from our own pockets, and donate it to SAR Education. That is a charity that benefits the education of girls in Afghanistan. It's a charity that I think this girl, Sharba Gula, would support. So thank you to our sponsor, Squarespace. If you need an amazing website or portfolio, Squarespace is the best place to do it. It's what Chelsea and I use for our own websites, and it can make your photos or your business look great. So head to squarespace.com/Tony, get a 14-day free trial, no credit card required, and if you decide that you like it and you want to keep it, you can use the coupon code Tony for 10% off. In 1984, National Geographic sent American photographer Steve McCurry to Afghanistan to take photos to support a story about the refugees living in Pakistan who'd been sent there from Afghanistan because of the Soviet war. According to Steve McCurry, he visits a refugee camp, hears the sounds of children laughing inside a makeshift schoolhouse, and he goes inside. He immediately spots this girl and notices her eyes. And he wants to take her picture. Sharbat is passionate, and she's over the age of 8, which means she's wearing a burqa that completely covers her face. It also means that she lives by a certain set of rules that forbid some things that might be common to you or me. For example, she can never really be in a room with a man who's not a family member. She certainly can't make eye contact or show her face. She cannot have her picture taken. And she definitely cannot have those photos publicized. But the only thing Steve likes about her is her green eyes. The burqa wouldn't allow that to show very well, so Steve, through his fixer, his translator, has the teacher instruct Sharbat to take off her burqa. According to Sharbat, she goes from being scared to being angry. But seeing her eyes is not enough. He wants to see her entire face. So he has the teacher instruct her to cooperate. He takes her from where she is, puts her in a different part of the room where there's better light and a nice, clean background. He poses her like an 80s glamour shot. Shoulder tilted towards the camera, forehead forward a little bit, nice light to illuminate the eyes, and direct eye contact, something she would never ever do. Steve composes the shot with negative space atop of the frame to allow it to become a magazine cover. That's really the only explanation I can come up with for the sort of unbalanced way that he composed it. It only makes sense if his intention is for it to become a magazine cover. He gets his shot and goes to take a roll of film. According to Steve, he had planned to take other pictures, but Sharbat takes off. According to Sharbat, she's scared to death, and she flees at the first opportunity. Notice no part of that story was Steve finding out her name, talking about her background, getting permission from her father, who was alive at the time. None of that mattered. The next summer, in June of 1985, this ships to millions of people worldwide, including a young Tony Northrup's house, and I still remember the day that we received this. I read the caption. It says, "Haunted eyes tell of an Afghan refugee's fears." If you read the article, you will find exactly one more sentence about her. It just says that her eyes are reflecting the fear of war, which is not true. Her eyes were reflecting the fear of an unfamiliar man, the fear of her personal boundaries being breached and her beliefs being trampled on. She had nothing else to be afraid of that day except for Steve McCurry. She had been living in that camp for a couple of years. She was in school. This photo goes on to win awards. Steve McCurry is widely celebrated. He builds a career mostly based on this one particular photo, and This girl, Sharbagula, has no idea that any of this is happening for 17 years. In 2002, National Geographic decides to do a follow-up special. They find Sharbagula. They use eye recognition and all this fancy tech to track her down, and they do eventually find her, and they want to recreate this photo. And then it's like a repeat of what happened to her when she was 10. First, they have a female photographer talking to her and taking pictures in order to verify that it's actually her. But then to get the picture that they needed for the magazine, they bring McCurry back. Even though she would have been comfortable with a female photographer, completely uncomfortable around McCurry, it had to be McCurry. Once again, Sharbat does not want to show her face. And once again, somebody pressures her into it. This time, it's her husband. And she does reluctantly show her face. Fast forward about 15 years to just a couple of years ago. According to Sharbat, she's lived a very hard and painful life. At this point, her husband has died and one of her daughters has died, but she still has three daughters and a son. That's when the Pakistani government comes for her. Because, see, she's still a refugee. Even though Pakistan is the only home she has ever known, she was not born there and she is not a citizen. She is a citizen of Afghanistan. Sharbat believes that if this picture had never been taken, she'd still be living in Pakistan, which she considered to be her home. Whew. Right? But I'm going to take an awkward moment to thank our sponsor, Squarespace. Squarespace makes amazing websites that we use for our portfolios and other aspects of our business. They make it extremely easy to set up. Simply drag and drop, and you can build a beautiful portfolio or just about any other type of website. If you'd like to check out Squarespace, it's totally free, no credit card required. Go to squarespace.com/Tony, and if you love it after a 14-day free trial, you can use the coupon code Tony to get 10% off. And as a reminder, all that Squarespace money is going right through to a charity that will support Sharbat's goals of educating Afghan women and hopefully keeping them out of early marriage. I started making this video wanting to celebrate this particular photo to discuss the impact that it had on my life and so many other lives. Look, I even bought the same model of lens that Steve McCurry used, 105mm Nikkor 2.5, but then I started researching the actual history of it. There were several things that I found really disturbing about this story. First, they violated her boundaries terribly when she was a 10-year-old girl. They used a position of power and the teacher's influence to make her do something that they knew she didn't want to do. How do I know she didn't want to do it? Because she finally got a chance to tell her own story after she was arrested in Pakistan. When she was deported to Afghanistan, their government kind of acknowledged, like, this is a person of note, a person who represents refugees, and we have to take care of her. It seems like a PR move to me. So the government of Afghanistan found her a home. And they promised to give her children health care and an education. And I think, in exchange, she had to do some TV appearances and interviews. Now, I'm guessing that she was required to do these interviews, because obviously they wouldn't disclose that part of it. But when you watch the interview, she doesn't seem like a particularly willing participant in it. And she seems to be hitting some of the same lines over and over again, that she loves being in her homeland of Afghanistan, despite the fact that after she was arrested while she was still in Pakistan, she was quoted as saying that Pakistan was the only home she ever knew and that she only wanted to live there. So her story changed a little bit. It would also be very convenient to Afghanistan. And frankly, if I were in her position, I would have said anything I had to do to get shelter and an education and healthcare for my kids. So I don't hold that against her. But during those interviews, she had some really honest moments where she discussed it. And here she is in her own words. In one interview, they asked her, "How did your husband react to the photograph?" "We are Pashtuns, so we became nervous and very sad." In another interview, she says, "I was a villager. I do not like the photo and the media." Steve's story is actually consistent with that. He seemed to be happy to tell part of the story where the little girl didn't want her picture taken, and he did it anyway. Point two that upsets me about this photo is that the story National Geographic tells about it is kind of untrue. They misrepresented her whole way of life. She was wearing a burqa and not a scarf. She would never have been alone in a room with a male photographer. She never would have shown her face. She would never have had her image published. They were supposed to be telling her story, and they told a completely different story. The most untrue part of how they portrayed her is that they said her eyes showed the fear of war. Her eyes showed the fear of a male photographer who was drastically violating her personal boundaries. Reason number three I find this disturbing is that this photo does not represent journalism. It represents unpaid modeling. Here's the thing. Steve Curry made a lot of money from this. National Geographic made a lot of money from this. This girl made nothing. And in journalism, that could be okay. Imagine you're a war photographer and you witness actual war crimes. You take that photo and you publish it in a journal for the world to see. That's important work. And obviously, you don't stop and get model releases for that. Because of that scenario, the U.S. legal system has certain protections set up for photojournalists, where you could pretty much freely publish a photo of anybody under any circumstances as long as it's classified as photojournalism. But nothing about how this photo was taken was journalistic. There was no urgency to it. She was just a girl in school who happened to be pretty. That was the only characteristic that they liked about her. She had an amazing story that they didn't bother to find out. They did not even ask her name. This was not journalism. Here's just a bit of her story. She grew up in a small village in Afghanistan. The Soviets came in, wanted to take it over. Her mother was killed in a bombing. Her father took her and her siblings, and they crossed through the mountains on foot into Pakistan and settled into a refugee camp there where they had lived for a couple of years by the time Steve McCurry found them. Her photo could have been journalism if it had been accompanied by her name and her story. But the photo was taken only for her looks. It did not represent her real scenario. It did not represent the way she really dressed or acted. It was taken completely out of context. It was actually misleading. McCurry just found a model that he could use for free. It didn't even matter that she was unwilling because she was a kid and she could be bossed around. After the photo was published, the photo itself became news, and Steve McCurry had been interviewed about it over and over again, and Steve still doesn't seem to be telling the true story. At least Steve's story doesn't seem to sync with Charbot's. Steve says she ran off to chat with friends. When he was on Oprah, Oprah says she ran off to play with her friends. When Charbot is interviewed, she says she ran away out of fear. Steve keeps saying she was 12 when the picture was taken, but according to Charbot, she was 10. Steve keeps saying that she was an orphan, but according to Charbot, she traveled to Pakistan with her father. When you watch the National Geographic reunion piece from 2002, they don't spend that much time covering her story. They actually spend more time just talking about her physical appearance. This is not journalism. So with all that said, I'm still of two minds about this, because there is good that came from this picture. National Geographic set up a charity for Afghan girls, and according to them, they raised over $1 million. Millions of people were inspired by this particular photo. She came to represent Afghan girls, even though she wasn't dressed in a natural way at all. And to many people, like a young Tony Northrup living in Pflugerville, Texas, that was probably the first time I saw a girl from Afghanistan or knew what Afghanistan even was. So maybe the photo didn't tell a true story, but it told a story that resonated. And if Steve had simply decided to take a picture of her in her burqa, probably would have made the cover, and maybe none of us never would have seen it. So maybe it played out the best after all. And Charbot seems to be in a better place now, with her children better taken care of. So maybe her story has a happy ending too. Do the ends justify the means? Do the needs of the many outweigh the needs of the few? I'd like to hear what you think, because I still haven't made up my mind about this photo. Thanks for listening to the Picture This podcast. It was brought to you by Squarespace. If you want your own awesome Squarespace website, go to squarespace.com/Tony. Get a 14-day free trial. Coupon code Tony will get you 10% off. And once again, all proceeds from this video, plus a big wad from my pocket, will go to the Sahar Education Charity, which supports education for young Afghan girls, something that Charbot Gula herself has said is the most important thing for her.